0 to 100, real quick. Real quick. Whole squad on the real. 0 to 100, real quick. Real quick. Real quick.
What's up, guys? I got my man Jordan Lowery in the house. How you doing there, buddy?
I'm doing great, Ryan. How are you?
Doing great. Doing great. I'm excited to talk to you today. Jordan, you've been in the business for quite a few years now. Not a ton of years, but how many years have you been in the business for?
4 years. I've had my insurance license 4 years. I worked at a captive company for 6 months, and then I've been at Family First Life for 3.5 years.
Nice. And you've built up an agency here at Family First Life, which should be all of our goals, so we can have some of that side income. But, how many families a month are you protecting now as an agency?
We're protecting about 1,000 to 1,200 every single week. So right around 4,000 a month.
4,000 guys a month. All right. So you just do the math on that. If we make an average of, you know what, per sale, that's a lot of money coming in, and a lot of people getting protected. So that's pretty exciting. Now, when you first started in the business, were you great outside the gate, or did you have some struggles?
I definitely had a lot of challenges. I definitely was a slow starter, not necessarily slow, like I was activity slow, but I just didn't know anything about it. So I just made a big mess. And then every single week on Sunday, I'd be cleaning up my messes, or just trying to chase down leads. But I definitely wasn't very good to start. I was 10, 12, 13,000 my first 2 months.
Okay. And then how much were you spending on leads a week? Let's reverse it. How much were you? What's your record month of families protected in a month?
35.
35 families a month. And then how much were you spending on leads a week during that record month?
During that one, I was spending about $2,500 a week. So I spent about $10,000 for the month in leads, and I issued 35.
There you go. So it's all about, if we spend more money, we have more opportunities, more families to get in front of. A lot of you guys out there, they're wondering, scratching their head, I don't get how they get these big numbers. They're just getting more chances, right? They're buying more requests for help and getting in front of more people. So that's just the ticket there. Now, if you could go back in time, and also through your knowledge of having a big agency and training a lot of agents over the years, what would you say is the biggest mistakes, or maybe list a few, that new agents make?
Well, you guys, for all of you that know me, that I'm just like every single one of you. And if you're watching this on recording, you know that I'm just like every single person who has a big insurance business is a normal person. So the normal mistakes that I see made are just normal human psychology mistakes, right? Most people haven't been self-employed or haven't been a business owner. They've never paid their own payroll. So the most common mistakes I see is people use their commissions in their first 60, 90 days. They use their business commissions for their personal bills. And then that puts them out of business because they have no more revenue or no more money to spend on the business. When really they did, they just used it for personal bills, and they ran out of money. So consistency over the first 6 months. No matter how good you think you're doing or how bad you think you're doing, your first year is just a learning curve that gives you 4 quarters to look at your amount spent on leads, your amount produced. And if you're not looking at it every single month, then you're failing yourself. But consistently being consistent and understanding that you're a business owner, you need a bookkeeper. You need to know how much you spent on leads. Even if you only spent $396 a week, you need to know you spent $396 a week. Not, I think I spent $400. You need to know what you spent, and you need to know what you grossed, because that'll give you real metrics to judge. Just people go in blind and they never want to look at the books because they're terrified or they're scared. It's okay to lose money. It's okay to not know what you're doing. It'd be weird if you knew what you're doing. That's what I tell people. I go, your first 6 months or your first 12 months, would it make sense, since you've never done this, that what I tell you to do, you've never heard it before? Yes, because you've never gotten this result. So I'll never steer you wrong. Just stay with me. And that's kind of how I set people up. It's going to be uncomfortable. And it's going to be backwards to having a job.
You know, a good perspective on it too is college last, does that last for 2 weeks or does it last for 4 years, right? To get your degree, it's not right away. And I want you to think of when you start this business, you correct me if I'm wrong on this, Jordan, but you know, people are too impatient. You know, you got to stick around for 1 year. If you can stick around for just 1 year, sacrifice some time and some investing in yourself, which is the time, and then invest in your leads, which is getting in front of, you know, people, you're going to figure it out. But if you're expecting results your first 2 weeks, it's not going to happen. I mean, no business is successful their first, you know, 2 weeks, right? I mean, you know, most businesses don't earn a profit for maybe 3 years, and most of them go out of business, right? So, you know, be patient with it and think about this like college. But I swear, if you just last a year, your college education is done, and then you are set for life. You figure it all out. You made all the mistakes. And now you're cruising, right? Would you agree?
I would say that, yeah, when you get through your first 100 appointments, that's like finishing your freshman year of college. And then after you get through appointment, you know, you get through 1 year, 12 months, that's literally like having an MBA. Like if you can make it 13 months running 30 appointments a week, 100, write this down, 120 appointments a month. So even if you only run 3 weeks, well, you might need to run 40, 40, 40, take a week off, right? So I challenge you all to track your appointment count monthly, no matter what your schedule looks like. And 100 appointments is your freshman year, and your first, you literally have an MBA after 13 months.
I love that. Yeah, and if you're not doing face-to-face, or if you're doing, you know, remote, track another metric. Track how many dials are you putting in daily to get in front of people. So you can track two metrics, you know, how many appointments are you setting, or, you know, how many sends on the phone are you pressing, right? It should be 3 sends in the morning, 3 sends in the afternoon, 3 sends in the evening. And then there's lots of text messaging we can send out as well. It's working great as well. So I can't tell you enough how excited I am to talk to Jordan. He's a great mentor to me as well. You know, humble and hungry, we all learn from each other. That's what makes FFL a great team and a great organization, and why we are the number one IMO in the country. But you know, this guy is a beast. So if you guys don't have your notepads out and ready, he knows how to communicate in a simple and easy way. So I'm just excited to hear what he's going to teach us today. And I'm always going to pick up something new from Jordan, because I love the way you spit your word tracks here. So take me through, you know, when you were running appointments, you were doing face-to-face. Have you ever done any remote work, or you doing mostly face-to-face?
I did do about, I did about 10 apps total, all telesales, but everything I sold was face-to-face. I'm a big believer in belly to belly and sitting at someone's kitchen table, because they're already going to lie to you a little bit, even belly to belly and face to face. So I just don't want to set myself up to miss any information when I'm brand new about, you know, renting or owning, or their mom and dad, you know, what that looked like for their family, if they've had any occurrences with life insurance. And I always got really nervous, Ryan. Like, I was a big sweater. I just got nervous. And so I knew that if I got nervous on the phone, they would hang up. But if I was with them, I would just say, you know, hey, I'm 90% sure where to go. Take a look at this and let me call my senior underwriter. And it just allowed me a lot of grace. And, you know, I can remember. So I'm a big believer in meeting people where they're at. You know, my grandmother had a stroke. So you guys got to get passionate about what you do, but you have to share your story. You know, my grandmother took care of my grandpa for 7 years when he was in a wheelchair from a stroke. And worst thing in the world is she ended up having a stroke 7 years later, and he passed away like a day or two after that. And now she had a stroke, can't talk, can't walk. And so I tell every client that, hey, we don't get to decide when an accident or a tragedy is going to happen. But I'm so passionate about protecting your family, because I wish someone would have protected mine. Does that make sense? And then it's a yes. So you guys, you have to share 2-4% about your family, you know, about medical challenges or financial challenges, or, you know, I've been sober from alcohol for a year. So these are challenges that I want to talk about to every single client that I sit with. Because if I open up 5% about me, I know that I can get them to open up 95% about them. But if I don't open up at all, then I'm going to get about 2-3% from them, and I'm not going to make the sale. It's going to be transactional, and I'm going to lose it. So open up, be vulnerable.
I love that. I love that. It's so true too. You know, a little bit of opening up. I mean, I think one of the lessons I've learned recently is, you know, I can handle criticism. So sometimes I pass it out too much. I'm trying to kind of tone that back. But oftentimes, you know, if you start off, you know, the reverse psychology of it, you go, hey, I forget to ask that. Sometimes people have a hard time bringing it up. It's like, hey, so how's our relationship going? Is there anything you want to bring up to me? Now I'm letting them criticize me. Now they're more open to take my criticism. So it's kind of like the opposite of that, but I just thought that was an interesting share. That's something I'm kind of working on right now.
Love that.
So Jordan, let's get into your presentation. Now, guys, when it comes to remote, whether you're doing a telesales, Zoom, if you guys want to do remote, the nice thing is you guys can set Zoom appointments and it has that like face-to-face feel, right? It feels like I'm kind of hanging out with Jordan right now, even though we're doing remote. So if you want that little extra face-to-face feel, maybe try remote with Zoom. You might have some better luck on that. I just wanted to try the more challenging route of doing the telesales so I can work in the backyard and take some dips in the pool and jump back out. But it is a lot tougher sale. Now you can get good at it, but if you have some leads in your local area, you know, we might recommend starting off face-to-face because it is an easier close. It's easier to build that trust. It's something you can physically touch. But if you want to go secondary, probably go Zoom. And then third, the hardest one's going to be your telesales. Now, all of them can be learned with repetition and just, you know, keep practicing over and over again. Eventually, it's going to click. The question is, are you going to quit, right? Are you going to give up too early, right?
So that's, are you going to get through the learning curve?
Are you going to get through your first 100 appointments and get your freshman degree, you said, right? The master's of the year. I love that expression. That was awesome. So let's take some notes, guys. Grab out the pens and papers and let's run through this. So run through how you set your appointments first. I'm going to throw out a couple of rebuttals so you can kind of see how you respond, and then we'll take us through an appointment.
Yeah, please do, guys. So everything is about control, control, control. Okay, so my tone is going to match Ryan's tone. So if he's an older lady, I might slow down. If he's a younger guy, I might speed up. But everything is about control. So ring, 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 ring.
Yeah, hello?
Ryan.
Yeah, this is Ryan.
Ryan, my name is Jordan Lowery. I'm just getting back to you real quick about your request for more information on the Arizona state regulated life insurance for final expense. And I just need to verify the information here real quick, Ryan, and I'll have you off the phone. I had you down as September of 1983. Is that true? And that's a delivery true. And a delivery address over at, looks like the Kane Corso Street. Is that you? Or is that's that it. An old address?
Yeah, that's it.
Perfect. So I'm assuming that you remember, Ryan, these are all non-medical. So what that means is they don't require a nurse to come out and do any physicals or do any needles or poke you with any blood, okay? I'm assuming you remember that. They just assign me to make sure that you are who you say you are, make sure that you're not, you know, strapped to a hospital bed or, you know, as big as a house or anything like that. Does that make sense?
That's making sense, yeah. How much does it cost, by the way?
Really great question. That's actually exactly why I'm calling. We'll get into all those details in the appointment. Now, real quick, Ryan, are you working part-time or full-time, or are you retired or disabled?
I'm working part-time.
Okay. Part-time, is that in the evenings, or is that weekends, or is it like Uber on call?
Just doing a little bit of Uber on call.
Okay, so when you want to work or when you need to work?
Right, basically, yeah. I mean, it's kind of semi-retired. I'm 65, but, you know, just to kind of make a little extra income here and there, I do the Uber.
Yes, sir. Well, you deserve it. You deserve it, and I know about that. Now, are you doing anything else like volunteering, or do you take care of your grandkids, or is it pretty much the semi-retirement and just Uber?
Yeah, we watch our grandkids on Tuesdays and Thursdays.
Okay, but you don't own any charities or volunteer any of your time every single day or week or anything like that?
Max, stop it. See, they're right there. Just giving them discipline. They're here today.
No problem. And are you usually driving Uber in the evening or during the day, Ryan?
Usually during the day. I'm not much of a night owl now that I'm getting up to those older years.
Okay, perfect. Well, so how this works, they actually have me dispatched in your area Friday and Saturday, seeing about 20 different families. So I don't have a lot of time. It takes about 7 to 10 minutes, depending how many questions you have. Are you a early riser, or do you like to kind of sleep in on Fridays and Saturdays generally?
Oh, I get up early. You know that I'm that old man, early guy. Early bird catches the worm, right?
Are you early like 4:35 or early like 6?
More like 6.
Okay, perfect. I don't have a 6, but I got a 6:45 a.m. I can knock you out first one of the day, or I can put 7:30 down. What would be better for you?
I'll see the 7:30.
The 7:30. Okay. And then if I put the cane Corso right in my GPS, is there any reason that would take me somewhere else, or it'll bring me right there?
Yeah, it should bring you right here. It's an older house. Okay.
Perfect. If I get lost, is this the best number to call?
Yeah, it's my cell.
Awesome, Ryan. Okay. Again, my name is Jordan Lowery. Now the computer is generating my confirmation code for our appointment. I have you down for Friday. Did you say 7:30 or did you say 6:30?
7:30.
7:30. Okay, perfect. I don't want to show up early with the coffee, you know? So I got you down at 7:30. And is it okay if I park on the driveway or the street?
Driveway is fine.
Perfect. Okay. Your code is going to be JL, just like my initials, Ryan, JL1013. Just make sure, when I show up, you know, just make sure the gate's unlocked. If I'm running behind, it'll really mess up my day. Okay. And I'll look forward to meeting you and helping you out.
Perfect. Hey, a couple things I want to break this down. Awesome job, guys. So drop a JL in the comments right now, some fire emojis, because that was fire. Now, he had complete control the entire time. And the great thing is, you know, when I spoke up, or he never stopped talking until I asked a question, but he was immediately picking up right away so that I wouldn't have any time for me to ask any rebuttals. He just kept control the whole time. So that was nice and smooth. I love the confirmation code that I threw out to Grady 3 years ago and started spreading around.
Yep.
That's awesome. Like the JL, that was cool. And the confirmation code can stay the same every single time. It's just kind of think of it as like an identity tag for yourself. So, and if you think about it logically, guys, it's not shady, because the insurance companies, our jobs are to make sure that we're checking identity, that sort of stuff. So why not have an extra identity check from the call to the person who show up at the house? So perfect, 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 perfect. Anything you want to add to that?
Well, I think it's never going to go as good as you think it's going. If you think it's a lay down, it's not. And if you think it's going really, really terrible, it's not. Sometimes people don't communicate the way you communicate. So I challenge you to just keep going. Just keep saying, that's actually exactly why I'm calling, and then move on. Clear the schedule. So being in control isn't asking for the appointment and then asking what they work and when they work and the hours they work. You got to clear the schedule first. So does that, so working part-time or full-time, do you volunteer? If you clear the schedule and then go to set, you guys will get, you'll get double the amount of appointments. So clear the schedule, be in control, and let them know that it only takes a lot of time if they have questions, because people like to feel like they're in control. At the end of the day, there's no one great script. Just be you, be a great you, dial fast. So when I'm hand dialing, I'm shooting for 40 to 60 dials an hour. So that's 40 if everyone's picking up. That's 60 if no one's picking up. Now, you should be using Ringy, and you should be using Phone Burner as well, unless you have negative $500 like when I started. But if you are, then you should be shooting for 80 to 120 dials an hour. So you can get done in 5 hours what used to take me 9. You can get done in 7 hours what used to take me 12, 13. So look, start to try to budget your anything for your business. Try to start budgeting annually. If I spend this money today, will I make more than this or less than this over the next 12 months? And if the answer is always more, then you should spend money on it. You should get as much money in that thing, in that tool. You're like, okay, one sale is 1200. Oh, I can make 10 sales. Okay, that's 12,000. Then I should buy that every single time. And that's thinking like a business owner. Buy your time, buy your tools. It's not an investment. It's a cost. It's not a cost. It's an investment. So that's what I want to add.
I love all that. I love that. You guys should take some notes, because this is good stuff. All right. And let's jump in. And the one thing I want to bring up too, guys, is, you know, follow your script at first, right? Because you guys aren't good enough, but eventually, you know, after you've hit your 100 appointments, another key thing is like, you can kind of start getting rid of the script and just being yourself, because your confidence is there. I mean, I was driving, you know, I didn't have any appointments booked, and driving to Lake Havasu, which is like 3 hours for me. And I would just call people and go, hey, I'm going to be there today. I got to get this done. So do you want the 3 or 5? like that was starting to be my script because my tonality was so confident. I'd be like, hey, you got to get off work because that's the only time I'm going to be here and I got to get this done. So get off at 4:30. I'll see you at 5:00. That's the only slot I got. So it was sometimes short like that, you know, so I'll see you in about 4 hours. Right. So again, as you kind of, your confidence and your tone is actually probably more important than the words. So write down the word trash, practice it a bunch. Once you've had your 100, maybe try to freestyle. I mean, what do you think, Jordan? I mean, eventually when you're doing your presentations, you probably just stop going off script and freestyling because you had enough practice with all your rebuttals and it probably flowed a little bit better, right?
Yeah, and but again, I do remember going 0 for 17 one time and thinking I would never sell insurance again. And so what I had to do is get back to the 8 steps of Paul McLean. And literally when I went step by step by step by step, because when you're selling the most insurance is when you're saying the exact same thing you just said 20 minutes prior and an hour prior and 2 hours prior. So it is repetition, but you know, be yourself, just be yourself. And then, you know, just meet the client where they're at, you know, ask them deep questions about their family. Have they dealt with this? Have they come out of pocket? How about their family? And it'll get easier, you know, as it, after 100 points, it just gets easier and easier. There's no new rebuttals.
Love it. Love it. All right. So knock, knock at the door. Let's go through the presentation.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Hey, hello,
Ryan. I was going to talk to you on the phone about the life insurance. Hey, are you a shoes on or off kind of house?
Oh, I'm so sorry. I completely forgot about the appointment. Shoot, is it possible that you could come back?
Yeah, I could obviously definitely come back, but I already drove all the way here. It was 45 minutes. I got up. Let's just knock it out now so I don't have to come back.
Okay.
Go throw a shirt on. Go throw a shirt on. I'll give you 2 minutes.
Yeah, let me put on my shirt.
Yeah, yeah. No big deal. By the way, which way is the kitchen table?
It's right over here. Yeah, come perfect, in. Let me get a shirt on here.
Take your time. Take your time. I got some emails to catch up on.
Okay.
Perfect. Perfect. So, and you come back with the shirt. So, hey, Ryan, I know how important this was to you. So I just wanted to make sure I drove out here. I didn't want to, you know, I didn't want something to happen before I got back. But real quick, I've got my state license right here with Arizona, just so you know that I'm a licensed representative with the state and the companies I represent. Also, do you have your driver's license on you as well? I'm going to need you to take a picture of mine. I'm going to have your info, so I need you to have mine.
Okay, yeah, got it. Here you go. Picture.
Boom, perfect. And so like I was telling you before, Ryan, now I'm an underwriter and a broker. So what I mean by that is an underwriter is I'm not the actual sales guy. My job is just to get you qualified for. So, and as a broker, do you know the difference between an agent and a broker, Ryan?
No, not familiar actually.
Okay. Well, I'll kind of back up and fill you in. So an agent is obviously like going to be where they are loyal or they work for the actual insurance company. So this is usually like those big conglomerates. So maybe like State Farm or Farmers, where they only work for one company. They're loyal to the company. Where a broker, they shop around all the companies. They're loyal to their clients. They work for you. Does that make sense? So an agent is loyal to the insurance company. A broker works on your behalf. Does that make sense?
That's making sense. Yeah.
So not only am I a broker, Ryan, but I'm also an underwriter. So I don't have any big sales pitch or anything. I represent all the A and A plus rated carriers. So I don't have any big sales pitch. My job is just to see what you can qualify for, because it wouldn't make sense to look at something you wouldn't qualify for. You know what I mean? And if we can find something affordable and comfortable for your budget and that you can qualify for, then we'll submit an application and we'll jump right in. Does that sound fair?
That sounds fair. I mean, I'm not sure if I'm going to make any decisions today. I just kind of want to see what the cost was.
No problem, Ryan. You don't have to make any decisions today. What you do with the information is up to you, but we need to see what you actually need, because not everyone needs mortgage protection or final expense. But what's important is that your needs are covered and your family is protected, is what you were telling me, right? So if you need it, you know, if you don't need it, I understand, but we need to see what you can qualify for to protect this house. So, you know, I hear you, but you know, my job is to see what you can qualify for. So let's just jump right in and see what the numbers say. Okay.
Sounds fair.
Now, real quick, I've got, state your legal name for me.
Ryan Reynolds.
Perfect. And your date of birth?
Blah, blah, blah.
Perfect. Now, do you own or rent here, Ryan?
I own.
Perfect. How long have you been here?
Good 25 years.
25 years. I bet you've seen this whole place change, huh?
Oh man, it's getting too packed here for sure.
Yeah, you got to take the good with the bad, you know. Now your mortgage, do you have a 15 year or a 30 year on the mortgage? What does that look like?
Right now I think we got about 17 more years on it.
Okay. And ballpark for me that monthly payment with taxes and title and insurance and everything. Just what does the bank want monthly?
Right now it's about 1280.
1280. And how much is the total left on the loan? What's the principal?
145,000.
Okay. Do you have any idea what they're saying it's worth? Is it a little over 300 or so, or a little bit more?
I think it's about like 380 right now.
380. Awesome. 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 It's crazy what appreciation's done here the last few years, huh? All the people.
Yeah, the last couple of years, it's gone crazy.
Now, real quick, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through 2 minutes of your finances and then 3 minutes of your health, because ultimately the insurance companies need to see what you're suitable for. So now, medications wise, what are you prescribed or been prescribed that you don't take or still are taking over the last 10 years? What prescriptions are you prescribed?
Right now, lisinopril for blood pressure, amlodipine for blood pressure, allopurinol for gout, insulin, metformin for diabetes, insulin diabetes, and glipizide for diabetes.
Wow. What was your last blood pressure reading that you recall? It doesn't have to be on number for number, but just that you remember, just ballpark.
It's like a 125 over 90.
125 over 90, and I circle it real big. I'm pulling out the inventory. So, okay. So it sounds like you're pretty on top of your health. Sounds like the medications are doing their job, mostly preventative stuff, but you do have some diabetes, high blood pressure, a little bit of preventative and maintenance stuff. Any heart attacks, strokes, cancers in the last 5 years, Ryan?
Yeah, I had a colon cancer about 4 years ago.
Did they catch it early?
Yeah, unfortunately they did. Yeah, then my checkup, they caught it.
Awesome. Did you have it? Did you have it removed, or were you treated with chemo?
Just had it removed. Just had a surgery. Got it early during the checkup.
How long have they said now that you've been cancer free? Just, you know, has it been over a year, or are you still on active treatment?
About 3.5 years.
Awesome, man. Well, it's just an honor to be able to meet you and serve you. I'm just glad I got to meet you. My brother-in-law is 31 dealing with stage 3 colon cancer right now. So he just started chemotherapy. So, you know, it doesn't discriminate. It doesn't matter if you're 21, 31, 91, you know, when it's your time, you know, we got to deal with these things. So I'm just glad that you were able to beat it. Now, any kidney or liver disease, anxiety or depression, any thyroid issues for you?
Take a sleeping pill, help me go to sleep at night, but can't remember the name of it.
Okay, no problem. And then any COPD or asthma, anything with your lungs? Are you a smoker, Ryan?
Non-smoker. Yeah, I take albuterol, just kind of seasonal though. ProAir, I think's the name of it.
Just depends what's kicking up in the air and stuff.
Yeah, just kind of if I get some bad allergies or the pollution gets too crazy here.
Okay. Now surgeries. Any surgeries in the past 6 months?
I had my hip replaced about 2 years ago.
2 years, but nothing in the last 6 months?
Nothing last 6 months, no.
Okay. And then now family, Ryan. Now mom and dad, are they still alive or have they passed?
My dad passed away at 85. He had a heart attack. My mom's still alive.
A heart attack. Does that run in your family? Do you know, as his brothers or any, does that kind of run in the family, hypertension or heart problems?
Yeah, I mean, usually most of us go with the heart issues or the cancers, but heart mostly.
Okay. And you said mom, how old is she still alive? How old is she?
She's, we'll say 87.
Okay. And any major medical conditions for mom?
She has a little bit of COPD, and congestive heart failure.
Okay. Just want to get an idea of what runs in your family, because that's what the insurance companies need to know. Does that make sense? So
right, now Pause. Now, why are we going over that? We're trying to paint a picture to scare them or about their health. So go into that a little bit.
Yeah. So, right. So I want to figure out what they've dealt with their mom and dad. Was it an accident? Were they sick? Was it cancer? Was it heart attacks? Was it strokes like my family? Were they teachers? Did they grow up with parents? I want to know what they've dealt with health-wise with their family and what runs in their family and what they're most likely thinking is going to happen to them.
This is good because, again, it's creating some emotions. It starts making them think that this could happen to me and painting a picture. This is really good. The blood pressure thing really doesn't matter, but he's asking it like he's a medical underwriter to really paint the picture, guys, of like, hey, you got to qualify for this stuff. Not everyone actually, you know, qualifies. So I think this is great. We haven't had this on one of the role play calls yet. This is good stuff. Talking about the parents, that's something I'm start doing. So that's some good notes I took, making a big deal about the blood pressure, even it's, you know, not a big deal, but we want to make sure that we're painting the picture that they have to qualify for this. Not everyone's approved. So that's an excellent stuff you're doing there. I love it. Yep. All right, let's go back to it.
So I think from there, right? So what as soon as I asked you about your mom and dad, Ryan, I'm going to go. So dad, you said it was 05. Now, did he have coverage like this that paid off the house? Did he have any protection to leave your mom and you?
No, he just had a small one that covered just the funeral, but yeah, it definitely put my mom in a harder spot. We kind of helped her out a little bit with some of the bills.
Got it. It's fair to say that your life would have been totally different if it would have paid off the house when he passed away.
Oh yeah, definitely would have helped out my mom for sure.
Yeah, I wish that he would have had coverage like this, but the good news, these plans nowadays, you know, they're so much better, right? So, you know, whatever it is, I just want to build some emotion there, you know? And so, okay, I bet that was really tough. What did that look like? Tell me more. How'd you raise the money? Okay. Now I'm jumping in after.
Teeing it up, guys. Yeah. I love it. Bringing out the emotion. This is good stuff.
Straight from there, I'm bouncing down to the bottom of the financial inventory sheet and the suitability sheet to the golden question, which is, now what do you have that acts like life insurance, Ryan? Do you have any 401ks or IRAs, or do you have any retirement accounts currently?
Yeah, I just retired you know, last year, so I think we got about 300,000 in an old 401k and about give me some other examples besides old 401ks that we should be searching for in that question.
So I would look at, any annuities that they might have, any bonds, any stocks, bonds, or mutual funds, or, governments, you know, CDs, any very low risk. Like Susan Orman, I think that's Susie Orman. She really loves bonds, right? Where a lot of people love fixed index annuities, things like that. But any type of cash accumulation or liquidated, any type of fund, we know that they can pass it to their beneficiary free of probate by using an FIA or by using not by basically, because a 401k is not necessarily the most. So when they say they have a 401k at work, I let's get back into role play. So that 300,000, Ryan, are you taking distributions on that already, or do you plan to when you have to at 72 or at 70 and a half?
Yeah, we're starting to kind of use it a little bit right now. Not a ton, but, you know, that's kind of why we saved it up since I just got in retirement. Trying to make it last, obviously, but, you know, we take about probably about $1,000 a month out of it right now. And then as we need more, we might take some more down the road, obviously.
Okay. Is it more like fun money? Is it more like money that you want to pass and inherit straight to your kids? Or is it just like, this is what I accumulated and I'm not really sure what I want to do with it?
Yeah, just kind of, again, money to kind of live off of for retirement. My kids are graduate college. They're all pretty successful. So just more for retirement purposes.
Okay. Sounds good. I want to make sure just that I know what that's for. We'll get back to that another time, but, you know, I want to make sure that we can secure that principal. You've worked your whole life to secure that $300,000. We don't ever want it to go below $300,000. If we can grow it, great, but we never want it to be less than that. Would you consider yourself more of a saver or an investor, Ryan? Like, if you had to pick one or the other, do you like risks? Are you like an investor? Or are you more of a saver?
Probably more of a saver.
Okay. Okay. We'll get to that in a little bit. Now,
Let's pause real quick. For the people that don't know why he's asking that question, give him some info on that.
Yeah. So if I'm searching for financials for a fixed index annuity and I'm going to tee it up to the advanced markets team, I want to already be thinking that I just want them to be thinking that risk is bad. Risk is bad. Risk is bad. Risk is bad. I'm not going to talk about it right now because I don't know anything about their accounts, their money. But I want when I set another appointment for 7 days or 10 days down the road that all they've been thinking about is risk is bad and safety is good. Risk is bad and safety is good. And that, you know, they should be in something that they can never lose, that has no ceiling, but has a floor. You know, it's exciting to have a floor because, you know, if you're, and I just, you know, we don't know what's going to go on with the interest rates, with the Fed, with everything. So it's just a good point. I want to know if they're a saver or if they're risky. So, but from there, you know, I'm building. So monthly income isn't something I ask, but I ask it the same way every time. So monthly income, Ryan, so you're retired. Do you have Social Security income and a pension or a retirement income coming in? What does that look like?
Just the Social Security and then the 401k.
Okay, Social Security, is that the first or the third of the month, or is it the third Wednesday?
Third Wednesday.
Okay, perfect. And then what is the Social Security after they take Medicare? What comes into your account?
That's about $2,300.
Okay, and then the retirement, how much is that? Is that about another 1,000 or is it a little more?
Bringing in about another 1,000 to 1,500, depending on it.
Okay. So about 3,800 before you do anything, and then Uber, maybe another $2,000 a month.
Yeah, pretty much.
So 5,800. Now, how much are you paying for your electric every month, and how much are you paying for your, like, what are your five biggest bills? So most people, it's their, so I already got your mortgage, but for their phone bills, their electric, their Wi-Fi, their car insurance, what are your five biggest bills every month, Ryan?
So electric's probably about 400.
400 a month.
Yeah, says I live in Arizona, so the AC costs. You know,
we got to get you some solar.
Yeah.
how about your car insurance?
Switch it to a solar cell. All right. Yeah, 400. We'll do car payments about 200. We'll do car insurance. Is about 75.
How much for your cell phone and your technology?
Every month? Like, you know, like the internet, phone, all that stuff, about $200.
Internet, phone, cable, is it about $200 or so, you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay. And then any other major credit card debt or any other debts or anything? Like, do you have any student loans that I'm not seeing? Is there anything I'm not seeing, or is this kind of the full picture?
That's the full picture. Yeah, no their debts.
You don't owe any alimony. There's nothing going out, sneaking out every month. You're not gambling every day. Nothing crazy.
No.
Okay. So it looks like we got, you know, a couple thousand of disposable income, but obviously the insurance company is going to make sure that it's suitable, that it's comfortable and affordable. But I want to break down their bigger bills so that they know 400, 200, 275. When they tell me that $100 a month is too much or $200 is too much, that they've told me all their other bills are 400, 200, 200, 200, and 175. So it's like, it'd be weird if it was $60. Like, it'd be weird. Like, I used to have this guy I trained, and he would sell 480 annual premium, 510 annual premium. And I was like, dude, you have to ask them what their other bills are. You can't even go to Chipotle for $50. You can't. You got to start building the value of their other bills and what this can do. Okay. So break it down weekly, right? So If it's going to be $200 a month, this is only $50 a week. This is only $60 a week. Okay. I'm obligated to show you the maximum you can qualify for. It's only $60 a week.
Love that. Only this amount a week. That's a good tip. Write it down, guys.
And that way they're going to just kind of pick the bigger option. You can always down close, but top down selling is what all Hall of Fame producers do. So that's all I want to give you guys right now as far as my financial inventory sheet. I don't want to get too out of order. I think there's a lot of things that we can overthink, but I think just being very intentional about the dial and the suitability sheet, you guys are going to make sales. You guys are great. You know, you're on here, you're working. Like, it's not hard to make sales if you're intentional with your inventory sheet. So, that's how I go through the inventory sheet. I'll quote them three options. Like, I'll quote them the most they can qualify for. If they don't pick it, I'll give them three options and they pick the middle one. And then I do the app and I'm out the door.
Perfect. Hey, let's hear your pitch though. I want to hear the, when you're giving the options, so we can kind of get some tonality and then how you talk about that. Cause, in this instance, we're going to go with a whole life, right? Yep. Are we talking about final expense at all? Cause we learned they have a mortgage.
So we're going to look at equity protection, but I'm going to take your 1280 and I'm going to just do a 10. I'm going to multiply it by 10, by 20, and by 30. And I'm just going to ballpark what that gives me, right? So 1280 times 10. So 1280 times two. So I'm going to show 12,000. You know, if they don't pick the 30,000 or the 35,000, then I'm going to show 12. I'm going to show basically 10 months, 20 months, and 30 months of the payment. So what the bank's going to want every single month, Ryan, regardless. So I need to get into the beneficiary. Let me get down to the beneficiary. So if something happens, yesterday and to me, and I didn't make it here, and to you at the same time on the highway, who'd be taking over the house payment? Who'd be selling the house, or what would that look like?
My kids, I guess, you know, they'd have to take that over.
Are they all local or?
No, they live in a different state.
Okay, who's the closest? Who could be here the fastest that you trust?
Probably my son, Jack.
Okay, Jack, little Jack Jr. And then if Jack, so would you agree that Jack, so he has his own bills, he's got his own, you know, mortgage, everything like that, but he probably won't need, you know, what the bank's going to want every single month is that 1280. They're not going to make Jack come in with all 140. I don't have here, but 145,000, but they're going to want every single month is they're going to want that 1,480. So what most people do is on, obviously, like you remember when you lost your dad is, you know, on the worst day is you're already thinking about 100 other things. How nice would it be that if it happens in January, you don't come home January, that February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October, the entire household is taken care of. Now you can do up to 36 months of it, but what most people do, Ryan, is they do 1 year because they know it takes a year to grieve and kind of get through. Now that's the minimum I would recommend is that 12,800, but the most what I'm obligated to show you is this 35,000. And I would show, right, if it's an accident, 70K, if you were 70 or younger, I would show 300,000 of accidental. But if for equity protection, you're talking in months. What everyone's gonna need is 10 months to run the household or 12 months to run the household where the bills aren't due, where they can take care and grieve their family. So, you know, this is the 10 months, this is the 20 months, and this is the 30 months right here, Ryan. This one is $65 a week. This one is $30 a week. And this one is $25 a week. Which one do you know you need? And then I just sit there.
Be quiet. Yep. Love it. Okay. Let's switch gears. So if it was a final expense one, give us some nuggets on that.
Sorry. I was reading a text. I'm sorry. One more time.
If it was final expense, give us some nuggets of how you'd switch gears on that.
Yeah. If it was for final expense and they didn't own a mortgage, essentially what I would do is I would talk to them about what that money could do for their son, right? So what did that look like for your dad? So how much do you have in your savings? What would that look like? What would the bills? So Ryan, so here, so Jack Jr., if you passed away yesterday and I didn't make it here, if I didn't make it here today and you passed away yesterday, what does that look like for Jack today? So obviously he's flying in, but what does that look like for him?
I mean, it'd definitely be stressful. I definitely remember my dad passed. It was to take off work and, you know, deal with all that stuff. He didn't have a plan in place. So, yeah, definitely.
But outside of work and stress, who's he calling? What does that look like? Do you know which funeral home? Who would he be calling? Let's walk through it together.
Yeah, I didn't think about that yet. Yeah, I don't know.
Okay. So I know. So have you updated your will in the past year?
No, I don't even have a will.
Okay. I'm going to give you a website. It's nothing I'm associated to, but it's doyourownwill.com. And you can take this down to your credit union or your bank and get it notarized. And this will act like a living document. So just so you want what your wish is, even if you write, you know, I, Ryan, want to be, you know, whatever you wish, whatever you want your belongings to go to, and get your will updated, okay? Because it's really important. I don't want your family. Now, if you had to make a decision today, because I didn't make it here, say I was in a bad rollover on the way today, and I didn't get here, and we didn't get this coverage in place, Ryan, who would he be calling? Like, if you had to decide right now, would you be cremated or would you be buried? Like, who would he be calling?
My family all get buried. But okay. Yeah, I guess I'll have to figure out the funeral home and all that stuff too.
Okay. So he'd be taking off work. So all of the house bills at his place are due. And then I'm assuming you understand that he has to take over your bills for at least a little bit. So, you know, I'm not sure, you know, if I recommend 15,000 minimally, but you could do up to 30, but ultimately, you know what you want, what your son needs, right? So what's the last gift you want to leave to him?
Yeah, making sure he's not worrying about, you know, any of these extra expenses that might occur, you know, my funeral, all that stuff. Yeah, it makes sense.
Do you think this 16,000 right here, Ryan, do you think this would help?
Oh, definitely.
Of course it would. Of course it would. Well, let's see if we can get you approved. We'll start with the 16 and you can always try to qualify for more in the future.
Okay. But it gets more expensive as I get older and if I get sick, right?
So the good news is if you qualify today, the price is locked in. So your premiums are never going to go up. Your benefits never going to go down. It's never going to expire. Okay. And if it's an accident, it'll double for your family. But let's just talk what we guarantee, because I don't want to say, hey, they might get this or they will get this. Let's talk about what we know they're going to get, because I don't like to say what you might get. I want to know what Jack's for sure going to get. So which one do you know he needs to start with?
I'm going to go with the 25,000, just get extra while it's on sale.
That's exactly what I would have done. This is healthy as you are and you're one prescription away from being uninsurable. So now real quick, Ryan, what that looks like is everything I've asked you today, we're going to go through again. So those questions can be a little repetitive, but the insurance companies are going to have me put it down in an application. So we're going to do a request for coverage. What that looks like for you is we're going to validate your banking info to make sure there's no insurance fraud on any of your accounts. We're also going to verify your identity, which I've already got your ID, and your social security. They're going to check your prescription history with the medical records to make sure everything you say is accurate and that we can get you qualified. Okay. And from there, they'll approve or deny you within a day or two, and your coverage will be in force and Jack will be protected as soon as you're qualified. The first draft will go out and the same time again next month. Okay.
Love it. Hey, that was great. Drop some JLs in there. The nugget that I want you guys to write down, this is a good one, man. I'm stealing it. You are one prescription away from being uninsurable. Ooh, ooh, that was good right there. That was good. I'm going to start going, oh, once I get all the medical, I'm like, wow, you're about one prescription away from being uninsurable. That was a zinger. Put it on your bulletin board. I love it. All right. Thanks so much, Jordan, man. It's been a pleasure. I know you got to get back to work. You're hustling. Peace.